Stephen Sondheim, thanks for talking to us.
My pleasure.
The thing that jumps out at me over and over again is this book is a love of craft, of process, of how a song works or sometimes doesn't. Is that right?
Yes. Well, I'm interested in all kinds of craft. I love to read about how people do things. I read cooking columns, and I don't cook, but the process is always what interests me. I'd be interested in reading about oyster farming. I'd be interested in reading about horse racing, things I know nothing about, providing it's specific and detailed, and it's a craft that somebody is passionate about and wants to convey it. I love learning, and that seems to me the best way to do it is to have a practitioner tell you what goes into it. And I'm not just talking about the creative arts. I'd be the same thing about running an insurance company. How do you do it? Exactly what goes on each day.
But you were eager to go back and look as you were looking at these lyrics from several decades to sort of see what worked and what didn't.
Well, I don't know that I was eager to do that. I was a little trepidatious about it. But I knew I wanted to talk about how I do it, how one writes a lyric, and how one makes a song for the stage.
Here's a quote early in the book. If poetry is the art of saying a lot in a little, lyric writing is the art of finding the right balance between saying too much and not enough.
Well, that's because lyrics go with music, and music is the richest of the arts because it's the most abstract. And it is so filled with emotion. If the lyric is too packed, then the ear, the audience's ear, can't take everything in. It's like an over-egged cake. It just is too rich. On the other hand, if the lyric is too sparse, it's dull. So it's always a juggling act to have the lyric just rich enough and just full of ideas enough and just full of surprises enough and just full of images enough. But if it's too much, poetry is the art of, as I said in the book, concision, in which images butt up against each other, in which resonance is everything. You don't always understand a poem. In fact, often you don't understand a poem on first reading. And a poem you can read at your own speed. If you don't get what that line is, you go back to the beginning of the line and look at it again, or you read three lines and then go back. You can't do that with a song. A song exists in time.
So is a song, how do you think of a song? Is it a little story? Is it more or less? I mean, what does it have to be successful?
What's successful, I don't know what you mean by successful.
Okay.
But to work in a show, in a story, storytelling show, which is the kind of show I'm interested in which songs express the story, express the characters, carry the story forward, then the song is like, as Oscar Hammerstein taught me, a sort of little one-act play in which you state an idea and then you develop it a bit and then you come to a conclusion. And if the song is what you would call successful in the show, it's because it moves a character from point A to point B, or moves the plot from point A to point B. But the point is, the song has to be necessary to telling the story. If you can take the song out and it doesn't leave a hole, then the song's not necessary.
One of the enjoyments of the book is for all the ideas about craft and how you write a song, that it has to fit into the process of the theater, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, the play's too long, we got to cut songs, right? Or the star needs a new song, write one.
Yeah.
All these things, you love that part of the process.
Oh, sure,
as well.
Absolutely. No, sure. What's fun about the theater is it's a living art. And you're working with living clay. And you get to change things and experiment with things. And even after a show is opened, you can still change it. You know, if you make a movie, it's set in aspic. It's going to be that way forever and ever, and you can never change it. But with a play, or with a musical particularly, you get to change it all the time, during the preview period and even after it opens. It's fun to experiment. And also, let's say you get a cast member gets replaced. You want to work now with a new cast member. Sometimes you even change something to accommodate the new cast member. Maybe you change something in the way of a melody or something in the way of a lyric.
Well, there's an example where you're writing for a particular... Originally, you're writing for a particular person,
mm-hmm.
right? So there's a good example, a story about Send in the Clowns. You're writing for Glynis Johns.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about learning what she can do and some of her limitations. And you say, once you figure that out,
mm-hmm.
you write, quote, the song wrote effortlessly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was kind of curious. The song... writes itself, in a sense?
Well, in a sense, because we were in rehearsals, so it's very useful when you have seen the actress play the scene, and you know what the scene's going to be, as opposed to it's just being on paper and being in your head, and you see what the actress can do, or singer can do and can't do, and you see the scene and what's required, then all the forces come into focus right away. You have less chance of making a mistake if you see the entire package, so to speak, all at once. And knowing what her vocal limitations and her vocal assets were, because she has a wonderful, sexy, breathy voice, and knowing that, it was much easier to write the song. When I say the song wrote itself, what I meant is I wrote it easily. I'm a slow writer, but in that case, I wrote in a couple of days.
Now, you mentioned Oscar Hammerstein. I want to just talk a little bit about how you learned to do what you do.
It's not apocryphal, it's slightly exaggerated, but I learned most of it in one afternoon. I was 15 years old and I'd written a show, and I was sure it was a school show, of course, it was about school, about the George School, which is a friend's school that I went to.
Write what you know, huh? But,
yeah, exactly, and it was all about the thinly disguised faculty members and students, and I really thought it was worthy of Broadway at the age of 15, so I brought it to him. I said, pretend this just crossed your desk and you've never seen it before. What do you think? And I thought he would say, well, we'll go into rehearsal next week. But instead of which he said, well, if that's the case, and I got to tell you, it's the worst thing I ever read. And he saw the shock on my face. He said, I didn't say it wasn't talented, but I'm going to tell you why. It's what's wrong with it. And he started, and he treated me like an adult, which is, of course, the best way to teach a kid. And I was just at that age when my brain was a sponge, and I gulped it all in, and I said, at the risk of hyperbole, that I learned more in that afternoon than most songwriters learn in a lifetime of writing, because he distilled all his knowledge in a few hours, and I just soaked it all in. And then when I was 17, I became his assistant on a show called Allegro, which was the third show that he and Rogers wrote. They'd written Oklahoma and Carousel. And then they wrote Allegro, and it coincided with my summer vacation from college. So I was a gopher. I got coffee, and I typed script, and I watched the process live. And what was great about it was the show was very ambitious, and it was a failure, both with the audiences and with critics. And to watch a group of extremely talented and accomplished people like Rodgers and Hammerstein and Agnes DeMille, who directed it, make mistakes is enormously valuable and a great experience.
But then in the book, you write about him, and you write about all kinds of other famous lyricists of the 20th century. But you have to distinguish yourself. I mean, you're writing about what you like, even about him, but also what you don't like.
Oh,
you
sure,
have to find
absolutely.
Your own voice.
Yeah, well, not only finding my own voice, but also he taught me to examine with laser-like focus on every word in a lyric and what the thoughts are and what
every
are you doing.
Every single word.
Every single word, because there's so few words in a lyric. It's, you know, I've often said, if you think of a lyric as a little one-act play, then each line is a scene. And you know, a quatrain becomes an entire act.
Each line is a scene,
and you got seven words So let's say each word is a speech. Well, you know, if you're writing a play and something's wrong with the speech, you cut or change the speech. Same way, you got to do it word by word. It is as focused as that, and that's essentially what he taught me to do. So I turned my spotlights on the work of the lyricists that most famous and most admirable in the history of the theater. And Oscar has a lot of things that I quarrel with. And if he were around today, I'd love to argue them with him.
Now, speaking of the importance of each word, I mean, one thing that comes through here is the student of rhyming, mm-hmm. right? What interests me, and on the one hand, it's the most basic thing, the nursery rhyme. I mean, mm-hmm. we grow up mm-hmm. learning to rhyme. And yet you do it professionally, and you have to come up with
a rhyme draws the ear's attention to the word. Yeah. So you don't make the least important word in the line the rhyme word. Yeah. So you have to, and also a rhyme can take something that is not too strong and make it much stronger. If you tell a joke in rhyme, it's twice as funny as it would be if you just told it in prose, if it was just a speech. The same words, but the rhyme does that to it. And that's one of the uses of rhyme, is not only to focus the attention on the word, but to strengthen what you're saying. So you can say something moderately banal, and it comes out to have much more life and vibrancy if it's rhymed sometimes. Now, sometimes you avoid a rhyme, because if you don't want to draw the ear's attention.
Because the ear's expecting.
Exactly right. So you want to fool them. Because one of the things you want to do in a song and in a scene and in a play is surprise an audience. You don't want them ahead of you, because if they're ahead of you, then they get bored. They say, oh, I saw that coming. It's an anticlimax. But if they didn't see it coming, that could be a scene or a character or a word. You can surprise them with a word, and that's often how you get a laugh, is to surprise them with a word.
Well, I mean, I want to give an example, because I was so interested in particular examples. You say words that are spelled differently but that sound alike engage the ear more than those that are spelled similarly. So the example, rougher and suffer, spelled differently.
It's better than rougher and tougher.
Exactly. Now that's because...
I think when we read and hear, I think we see words as if they were on paper sometimes when you hear them. I don't mean it's an absolutely conscious thing, but I'm absolutely convinced that people essentially see what they're hearing.
So I'm hearing reference of the rhyme, but and then I quickly think,
and
wait,
think,
wait,
well,
I didn't
that's
know
a surprise.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I've got a rhyme in Passion, Colonel and Journal. That you look at them on paper, they seem to have no relation to each other at all. Right. So when you rhyme them, it's ooh, you know? It's a, I really may be wrong about this. It's just something that has struck me over the years.
And is it true that you rely on, I want to get this right, a 1936 edition of a rhyming dictionary and a 1946 edition of Roget's Thesaurus?
Yeah, exactly. Well, the Thesaurus, for a very good reason, each edition, they make a different balance between the number of words and the number of cross-references. And the earlier editions didn't have enough words in them. And the subsequent editions have too many words in them, so you don't get as much of, in the way of cross-reference. And I found that this particular 46 or 47 is the one that has the right balance, so I have a number of copies of it marked up. And the same thing with Rhyming Dictionary, although it's the Clement Wood Rhyming Dictionary, and I like it because the rhymes are all listed vertically, so that if you're looking for a rhyme, your eye is going down the page. If your eye goes across the page, it soon starts to speed up and you start skipping words. But when the eye goes down the page, there's a tendency to stop at each word, a mini second when you stop at each word, so it's much, much better. That rhyming dictionary has been updated, and I haven't used the new one a lot, but it has many more words in it because, of course, there were so many fewer words back in 1936.
And do you use these books at the piano, or when?
No, I use them. I write lying down on a.
You write lying down.
Yeah, so I can fall asleep. Yeah, I've done that ever since I was.
So you can fall asleep if things aren't working.
You got it exactly.
Oh, okay.
And I do it. Yeah. A little 30-second, 1 minute, or 5 minute nap doesn't hurt. And then I pop up and go to the piano.
Now, the other thing you write that's kind of fun to read in the book is when you kind of make fun of yourself because you can overdo or you could get rhymes wrong.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Now, there's a great example here where you sort of mock yourself. The one that will be familiar to a lot of people is from West Side Story, Maria.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
She's singing, "It's alarming how charming I feel."
Yeah.
And you sort of say, how could a...
Well, it's just, it's far too sophisticated a kind of phrase for a Puerto Rican girl to say. It sounds like there's a writer in the room.
You say the lyricist wants to show off his rhyming skills.
Right. Well, yeah,
meaning
see,
yourself.
Most of the rhymes in West Side Story are, you know, very simple rhymes, you know, go and so and may and day and things like that. And it was my first Broadway show. I wanted to show that I could rhyme skillfully, so I could.
Yeah, but people love it.
Yeah, well, they love it, but they shouldn't.
We love it, but we shouldn't.
What I mean is, you'd love it more if it was more true to the character. That's all.
I see.
That's all. I don't mean that you should sit there and say, oh, that's terrible. But I tell you, unconsciously, it rings a false note. I just know it does. I don't mean that you could take a poll of the audience, but I say that it would ring a false note.
And if you went and wrote it today, it would be very
different. I don't think I'd use an inner rhyme. I don't think I'd use it. Even just any inner rhyme. It isn't just the word alarming. I mean, who uses a phrase like that? Oh, how alarming to see you. I mean, no, it's a literary word. It's a literary word. And
go to the theater to get a little bit extra?
Oh, sure, of course. But you got to be true to the character. No, I think what you go to the theater for these musicals, the kind I like, is to be lost in the story. Now, if wordplay is, for example, Little Night Music is filled with wordplay. It's a group of very sophisticated, very articulate people. So I get a chance to play with words. Yes, and wordplay is a great delight for an audience. Of course it is. It is for me. I think it's wonderful. It's like the what's good about light verse.
One more example. The criticism, when it comes, is always you know, it's too cold, it's too cerebral, right? And you used that example in Merrily We Roll Along of the song where the character, the producer, Broadway producer, is making, sort of mocking the lyricist and the composer, saying it's not hummable. Couldn't you throw him a crumb, I think is the way the...
Why can't you give him a crumb?
Can't you give him a crumb?
Yeah. Listen, people who think that my stuff is too cerebral, what can I say? I don't think it is. All writing is cerebral in the sense that it's been thought out. If strikes people as cold, I don't think that accusation is so strong anymore. That was much more at the beginning of my career. I think people, when they get to see the shows more than once, maybe they realize they're not cold shows.
I think you're right about that. Okay, you're 80 years old, right? It's been a...
How'd you hear?
Sorry?
Who told you?
Yeah, well, I'm sorry to point it out, but you're being feted all year, right? Grandmaster and all. But we're decades into a very changed musical theater, very changed Broadway, and you've seen it. Where are we now? What do you see when you?
I don't take an overview of the Broadway theater. It changes a lot, the way all culture is changing rapidly. And the real problem, and unfortunately it's the perennial problem, is the economic one. It's the fact that young voices aren't getting a chance to be heard because producers have to raise $12, $15, $20 million to put on a show, and they're not going to take a chance on an unknown writer or writers. So they will take a brand name, a brand mark. They'll take a Disney show with, you know, that comes with a title like Beauty and the Beast or something like that.
Where the audience knows what they're going to get.
Exactly. So or what they call the jukebox musicals, which are musicals that aren't so much musicals but really concerts of familiar songs, sometimes tied into a story because the audience is humming the tunes as they go into the theater rather than just humming them when they come out. And I can understand that safety play on the part of producers, but it's terrible because young writers aren't getting a chance. And the major thing is, you cannot write shows just on paper. You learn to write by writing in front of an audience. That's the difference between writing for the theater and writing books or painting paintings. You learn by doing, and you can only do it that way. Nobody writes a sensational show the first time out. They just don't, because they have to learn the craft. And the craft is not just the craft of writing. It's the craft of doing. It's the craft of putting it on. It's the craft of the combination of the orchestra and the singers and the final collaborator, the audience. Because the audience is the final collaborator on every show. And until you work with that collaborator, you haven't written a show.
And what about you at 80? With all the celebration, with all this book kind of looking back at your career, are you still working?
I'm not as hungry as I used to be, and I'm fearful of people expecting too much. But when I finish the second volume of the book, yeah, then I'll get back to the piano.
All right. Stephen Sondheim, thanks for talking to us.
Nice to meet you.